Thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight. Good evening. I am standing in for the mayor tonight. He, again, could not be in two places at one time. But on behalf of the mayor and the members of the city council, I want to welcome you to tonight's Connecting Fairfax City for All Listen and Learn session. Really excited about tonight's program. We have Carla Bruce, who is the Chief Equity Officer for Fairfax County. We have Dr. Wendy Manuel Scott, who is the co-chair of George Mason University's Anti-Racism Inclusive Excellence Task Force. And we have Gretchen Bulova, who is the director of the Office of Historic Alexandria, I almost said Historic Fairfax, and co-chair of Alexandria's Remembrance Project. We're gonna have a panel discussion tonight. Dr. Wendy Manuel Scott is going to go first, and then we'll have a couple of questions with her before we move on to the others, because she has some other engagements to attend to. We would ask that you stick around for this entire session. It's going to be a little different than we've done in the past. Normally, we would break out into small groups. Tonight, we are not going to break out into small groups. At the end of the presentations, we will have some question and answer time with the panelists, which will be really great. We will ask at that time that you put your questions in the chat, and we will go through them with the panelists from there. Thank you very much. And for right now, I am going to hand it over to our Director of Historic Resources, Susan Gray, who will introduce this program more. Thank you, Susan. Want to take it away?
Yes. Thank you, Melanie, and welcome everyone to the May 20th Community Listening and Learning Session. And for this one, we're very pleased to be able to hear from three of our neighbors, Fairfax County, George Mason University, and the City of Fairfax, and on different initiatives and projects that all three of those communities are pursuing in the broader area of what we're studying, also of racial and social injustice, and how to build a more inclusive community here in the City of Fairfax. So I'm just delighted that we have these three presenters with us, and who will be sharing information from their jurisdictions and communities. And I really think here in Northern Virginia, I see all of us as a part of a wider community. We have so many things in common, and certainly these issues do not stop at any border. And so I'd like to just start with introducing our first speaker, Dr. Wendy Manuel Scott. She is a professor of integrated studies and history at George Mason University. She has a bachelor's degree in history from the University of Charleston and her PhD from Howard University. She spent a lot of time researching and investigating what's called New World slave systems, also the Jim Crow era of segregation in our country. And one thing that really hit me with Dr. Scott's Manuel Scott's bio is this quote, which she likes to bring to all of her research and to her students, that says, "History, quote, history is relevant to all lives, regardless of a student's chosen major, interest, or professional leanings." And as a historian, I firmly believe in that, as you might imagine. And I know that many people on the call, including Gretchen Bulova, will certainly agree with that. And a special project that she's been working on is looking at the enslaved people who lived at George Mason's Gunston Hall and George Mason as a slaveholder. So with that, I'd like to turn the program over to Dr. Manuel Scott, who's going to talk to us today about her position with the Racial Inclusion Project at George Mason University. Welcome, and I hope your mother arrived safely. That's the most important thing.
Yes, my mother arrived from Atlanta. She's upstairs, it's lovely to see her. My father passed away in September, and I haven't seen her since we said goodbye to my dad. So it's nice to be able to spend time with her unmasked now that we're all vaccinated. And she gets to see grandchildren and her new two grand pets, a pandemic dog and a pandemic cat. So, but I'm happy to share a bit of time with all of you this evening. Thank you for such a lovely introduction. Carla and I have met and sat in a virtual space before, so I'm pleased to join her as one of the panelists this evening. So I think if I'm correct, I have about 20-ish minutes. Is that correct? Wonderful. So I'm going to jump right in, and I will try to indicate when or where you can find additional information if that's something of interest to you. But I'll try to pack in a good bit in the 20 minutes, and then leave a little bit of time as well if there are some questions that you would like me to respond to. But you know, I'm always available if there are some additional follow-up that might be requested. So what I'm going to do is, hopefully I have, yep, sharing abilities, and I'm going to share my PowerPoint. Let's see if I can make it nice and large. All right. So as it's already been mentioned, George Mason initiated actually about a little less than a year ago, our anti-racist or anti-racism and inclusive excellence initiative. And it started, or it was started, by our new president, Dr. Gregory Washington, and he joined us last summer. And we were all so impressed with him, knowing he was coming to Mason as our new president. Angel Cabrera passed the baton to him. And really right off the bat, our new president, Dr. Gregory Washington, really showed up with his sleeves rolled up, ready to do work, and recognizing that we were at a critical moment, not only as a nation, which we've all witnessed, but also as an institution. And so one of the first things that he did was to institute this Anti-Racist Inclusive Excellence Initiative, which we all call ARI, across campus. And so what I want to do with my time is just paint you a bit of a picture about the work of ARI, some of the recommendations that we've presented and that Mason will be moving forward with. And then I also want to take a little bit of a deep dive and showcase some of the work that we've been doing around the Enslaved People of George Mason Memorial Project, which preceded the ARI initiative, but nevertheless is a central pillar of the ARI work. So this is my co-chair, Shanita Walker. The two of us together have facilitated multiple meetings, planning sessions with the more than 130 ARI Task Force members. They did incredible work. And toward the end of that work, we hosted two town halls, virtual town halls, for the entire Mason community. And the first town hall, which was in February, we had nearly 500 individuals that participated. Listened in on the town hall. They submitted questions both in advance of the town hall, more questions, comments, thoughts, feedback after the town hall. And we followed up with that first one with the second one. We saw that as an opportunity, and the president thought that it was really important to be able to respond and engage with our large and diverse university community. So just to give you a sense, I'm just gonna run through and give you kind of highlights here of the way we decided to organize the ARI task force and the recommendations, we have multiple committees. The student voice committee was really important to all of us because we recognize that we should not be doing work without students embedded in all of the work, embedded in thinking about what they need as students. And so the students had their own committee, but they were also embedded in each of the other committees as well. They critiqued, they offered feedback to all of the recommendations that were created, and we welcomed. And I think all of us were really thrilled to see the level of investment that our students were willing to make to this work. So in terms of the central committees, one of the main committees we entitled University Policies and Practices. And the president tasked all of the members of this committee with really taking a deep and courageous look at where institutional inequality existed and the way in which the institutional policy was embedded in policies and practices, and that we needed to identify that, and that we needed to think about how we needed to change, how we needed to transform those policies and procedures, those institutional roadblocks, so that we can truly live up to who we say we are as an institution. And so for an example, they did incredible work, and in their report that they offered was well over 40 pages. So they have a lot of feedback, they use a lot of data and very detailed recommendations in terms of transforming our institution and making sure that it is more inclusive. And I'll also note here, while obviously we have thought a lot about the way in which racial inequities exist within our campus, we are also very aware of also identifying where there are gender inequities or where there are inequities in terms of people with different disabilities. And so we are absolutely thinking about the ARI task force, although it's called anti-racism, it is a big picture network of staff, faculty, and students doing this work. And it is a work that sees the intersection between different structures and policies that do not allow all of our community to really show up and be the best of who they are. And so I think that's important to note. You know, sometimes in collegiate spaces, we use the big fancy word intersectionality, thinking about the way systems of exclusion, racism, sexism, classism, ableism, the way they interact and don't allow folks to show up fully and be seen fully. And so we've taken an intersectional approach in all of the work that we've been doing. So the other committee is training and development. And here what we realize is that you can begin to think carefully about reimagining policies and procedures, but all of us, all of the community must be prepared to do that work. And so the training and development committee is really thought carefully about how we can train, how we can provide workshops and sustained and ongoing workshops, learning opportunities for everyone. That includes students, faculty, and also thinking about staff across the campus at all of our different campuses. And then the curriculum and pedagogy committee, this was a little close to my heart because we were doing a lot of work around revising and rethinking curriculum and pedagogy prior to the ARI task force being created. And at George Mason University, we've had students for, I've been at Mason just over 18 years. And I would say for the last 6 to 8 years, we've had students make a series of requests regarding better training for faculty so that they are more responsive, culturally responsive to the diversity of students in the classroom. Students have also asked that we have a course for all students to take so that they are better prepared to engage a diverse and global world. And so one of the recommendations that's come out of the curriculum and pedagogy group is the design of a course so that students can be prepared to be culturally responsible global citizens, in addition to other opportunities to help faculty revise their curriculum, their syllabi, and other units across campus in terms of programming, so that we can make sure that the programming is also culturally responsive and recognizing the diversity of students at our campus. That includes vets, again, that includes those that are differently abled, those that are gender fluid, those that are mothers, are nursing folks. We really want to make sure we are creating a community for everyone, and everyone is prepared for that. Oops. Our campus and community engagement committee had a, oh my goodness, my puppy's got a toy. They have a huge task with thinking about the policing on campus, thinking about our truth and racial healing center that's newly established, so that they can continue to do work both in and outside of the classroom. And so they have a kind of huge portfolio of tasks that they have focused on, but they've made some tremendous recommendations again that we think that will really allow us to leverage the best of what Mason is, but also finding those weak spots and strengthening them. And I will say our students have been pretty noisy, loud, and vocal about wanting, yes, to feel safe on campus, but also to feel as if that safety is a collaborative relationship, a positive relationship between students and our police. And so that's been a particular area that folks have committed a lot of time and energy and thoughtfulness toward developing recommendations that are going to be impactful. And then we have the research, a research committee, and just thinking about the ways in which research, scholarship, creative activities, that work also needs to represent the totality of our Mason community, that we need to make sure we are providing funding, fellowships, scholarships, international opportunities for our undergraduate, graduate, and continuing education students. And so this committee has come up with some really fantastic and creative research strategies to make sure, again, that we really are promoting diversity and inclusion in terms of research opportunities. And you can see each of these committees, it's they've got co-chairs, and they've got many different committee members from across the campus. We were particularly mindful to make sure that the committee members were both multi and interdisciplinary. Sometimes, you know, humanities can be kind of heavy in committee work, and we were very intentional to make sure that there were diversity of disciplines with voices on each of the committees. Okay, so I'm gonna kind of stop there. I don't have my, okay. And to say, I know that's really, really kind of quick look. If you are interested or you would like to get a better understanding of some of the more specific work of the committees, if you wanna hear more about the recommendations, if you simply Google GMU and RE Task Force, we've got, the full layout of the committee recommendations detailed 1, 2, 3 with some of the milestones. We also have recordings of the first and the second town hall. Some of that is even broken out with just excerpts from the president. I'm talking about his goals and kind of his guiding principles in terms of Ari's work. So if any of that's of interest to you, again, a quick Google in terms of GMU RE Task Force, A-R-I-E. Now, I mentioned at the very beginning that a lot of work was already taking place prior to Dr. Washington's arrival. For example, work around transforming our policing. Another example would be thinking about the creation of a course that all students might take, so that they could better engage our world as culturally responsive global citizens. Another effort that was already moving forward prior to ARI was that of the Enslaved People of George Mason Memorial. And I want to highlight this for you because I do think it speaks to the work of ARI in terms of the institutional transformation, in terms of the importance of thinking carefully and critically about policies, about procedures, about curriculum, all of that, right? All of that work must be done. And, right, some of that work is literally about transforming or thinking carefully about our landscape, about geography, and the way in which geography plays an important role in terms of important role in terms of thinking about how all of us interact in space. And so the Enslaved People of George Mason Memorial Project, I think, is a perfect example of bringing together all of those kind of many elements, right, into the lived space, the very landscape of our Fairfax campus. So just to give you a quick history of that effort, back in 2017, a group of 5 undergrads and 3 faculty members assembled for a summer project funded by Mason, and they were curious about George Mason IV. Now again, many of our students had started asking questions about George Mason IV. Many had no idea that he was even a slaveholder. And so once these students and others began to ask those questions, faculty, moved by student inquiry, decided to initiate a summer project. 5 students were selected to be a part of this effort. And this is a photo of them presenting, their final research. And so as a result of that student work, then President Cabrera was really impressed and he wanted to talk to the students. And so what we decided to do was that the students would go out to Gunston Hall with then President Cabrera. They would give him a tour of Gunston Hall based on their research in the Gunston Hall archives, in the Fairfax County Courthouse. Some of them went down to UVA to do some work. And he was blown away by their presentation and asked them, well, what's their big dream? And so our students said, well, their big dream was that maybe one day we would have some type of memorial on campus that would bring attention to the lives, the experiences of the enslaved people held by George Mason IV at Gunston Hall. And the president said, well, we're in the middle of a complete campus overhaul. We're gonna be building new buildings. Maybe you should go talk to the architects. So, wow, so off we went. And we shared this story with other administrators at Mason. And eventually that went all the way to the Board of Visitors, who were again blown away. And we received unanimous approval to design a memorial and to build a memorial. And so I just wanna show you a little bit of it. These are some early renderings. And part of our early conversation was, well, do we get rid of the George Mason statue? And what we decided, working with the students, I am one of several other faculty members, Dr. Benedict Carton and Dr. George Oberle, who we are all historians. And what we decided, what we wanted to do as an institution of higher ed is that we wanted to complicate how our Mason community thought about George Mason IV. And the way that we wanted to complicate that was to create a new base for the George Mason statue that would include 4 excerpts that George Mason IV penned. Before this, it's just set on a kind of blank base. I'll come back to these slides in a moment if you want me to. That'll work. And so in addition to reimagining the base of the George Mason statue, we also wanted to include several other elements that would, again, tell several stories at the same time. And so one of the stories, one of the narratives that we wanted to include was the story of Penny, a young 10-year-old girl who was taken from her plantation in Maryland to Gunston Hall. And she became the caretaker for George Mason's daughter, Anne. And so there will be a panel installed that will give a brief history of Penny, and it will include all of the names of the enslaved children held at Gunston Hall. But here is the, I think, one of the most amazing things about the memorial. Individuals will be able to stand on a panel, a spot on the ground, just back from the Penny panel, look through Penny at the George Mason statue. And so what we are suggesting, again, I think this also speaks to the RE task force, is that doing the messy work of identifying where inequity exists, doing the messy work of saying that we have some examples of racism that are embedded in our policies and we need to change that. Doing that messy work requires us to do deep critical thinking. It requires us to consider the complexities, right? And so this memorial also asks that of all visitors, right? To consider Penny as the enslaved child in relationship to George Mason IV, the slaveholder. And we got to hold both of those things. And then there's a second panel, and that is the panel of James. James was George Mason IV's manservant. So there is a little context provided on one of the panels. And then on the other side right here, we have the names of all of the enslaved men and women held at Gunston Hall. And Roger Wilkins was one of our most phenomenal historians at George Mason. He also worked for the Washington Post, award-winning journalist. And he, if you have not read his book called Jefferson's Pillow, it's a thin little book, but quite profound text. And we pulled this quote from his book, "They Did Not Just Endure. They lived and created and passed down strength and power and hope and love." And so also thinking about resiliency, thinking about resistance. And what that means, I think, for us as an incredibly diverse university at Mason, we have students from all around the world, more than 100 languages spoken at George Mason. And so wanting to remind people of that while we are also working to be even a more inclusive institution. And so this is, I was looking for this slide earlier, the base of the statue. It will have, for example, an excerpt from George Mason's last will and testament. Also an excerpt from the Declaration, Virginia Declaration of Rights, a letter to his son, that are all, again, embedded in the base. And then in addition, our students in working at Gunston Hall and with archaeologists who did some work at Gunston Hall learned that there was a brick that enslaved folks created, but it was a brick that was made in error because their thumbprint was embedded in the brick, and it was discarded and then later found by during an archaeological dig. And so we were able to make a 3D rendering of that as a bronze brick, and that will be placed in the base of the holding the statue. And again, really invoking or encouraging all members of our community to think about the contribution of enslaved people to the United States and what that means. And again, at the same time, remembering our responsibility to make sure that George Mason and our nation, right, that they are more inclusive. And so when and where we find impediments to that inclusion, we need to do the work of reimagining and building something that is a place where everyone can be successful and thrive. Another element will be a fountain that will also be a part of the memorial between the two panels, the Penny and the James panel. And so let me see, I'm gonna jump forward a bit. These are just a couple images to give you a sense of the work over the years since 2017 in terms of designing every single element of the memorial. This was taken fairly recently. The making of the panels, you can see they're beginning to etch into the metal itself. I have not seen the finished product yet. I cannot wait, to see what that's gonna look like. And just a few weeks ago, I went to campus to see the progress. This was the base before they started to actually, George Mason will be coming back at the end of the summer, but this is the base that they are creating. And you can see some of the work that's taking place. That's me kind of looking at where the bronze brick replica is going to go. First time I've ever put on a hard hat, which is really kind of fun. Again, looking at the progress of the installation. This is such an exciting element. I mentioned a moment ago that there will be this water feature between the two panels, but you will note the stones. So one of the other things that the students learned during their research and in speaking with the archaeologist is that during a dig, they found a kind of sunken space beneath where one of the slave cabins was located at Gunston Hall. And in that space, they found shells and rocks that were laid out in a cylindrical fashion. Now, based on other research at other plantations in Virginia and other states as well, we know that enslaved Africans often maintained and held on to their culture, to their African religious and cultural practices. And that cylindrical fashion held a lot of meaning. And what we wanted to do through the memorial was to hint at that discovery at Gunston Hall through this rock formation that will be in the base of the water feature. And the water feature there is also a site of calm, a site of reflection and consideration for our community at the same time. So it was really quite amazing to see the work being done. You can see here, the care taken to lay each and every single stone in this very detailed fashion. This element here will have another quote by Roger Wilkins that'll be engraved. I actually saw it just yesterday, so they've made a bit of progress since I took these images. And so when I talk about reimagining the landscape, again, I think for all of us, for Fairfax, even for the Commonwealth and thinking about the One Virginia Plan, or thinking about the One Fairfax and the work that Alexandria is doing. Yes, we are thinking and considering what it means to transform the landscape, to rethink the geography, to think about what we name places and buildings and streets and schools. All of that is critical work. But there is also the kind of the landscape of the way in which knowledge is created and the landscape of our organizations in terms of policies and procedures. And so all of that deserves consideration, deep thinking. It requires courageousness from us. And sometimes you gotta dig a little dirt. Sometimes you have to, you know, put on your hard hat. But I believe that when we all commit to doing this hard, difficult, complicated work and transforming our geographies and transforming our institutions, our policies, our curricula, we are in fact creating a more inclusive world for us, for our students, and for our neighbors.
Thank you, Dr. Manuel Scott. Certainly, that was a very thought-provoking presentation. As you said, with a broad picture of Ari, and I'm glad we can call it Ari because otherwise it's a very
it's too much.
And our short name, we say Connecting Fairfax City for All, but the other part of that is to examine both past and present racial and social injustices. So certainly you have given us a wonderful path to look at how we can, when we move ahead beyond just considering Confederate-related items and symbols, in the city to look more broadly at those issues in our community. And so it's wonderful work that I think you're involved with there at George Mason University. I did see some of the temporary panels that were up just before the pandemic. So I think we all need to plan a field trip when things are finished. It would be very, very evocative, I think, to be able to see what's been done there.
There'll be ribbon cutting this fall.
Okay. And with that, I'd like to see if there are any questions in the chat or otherwise. Anyone have a question or a point of discussion? Well, I don't see anything. Oh, wait a minute, here we go. This is a thank you. Loved hearing about the great work going on at Mason. Thank you for your leadership with this. Any other comments or questions? Oh, here Susan, we go. Go ahead, Melanie.
Nope, I was gonna ask a question, but they're coming in, so okay. We'll go ahead with these.
Yes. Yeah, overlap on the mm-hmm. committees. There is in fact some overlap on the committees, yes. And even when we started to look at the recommendations, right, there's overlap there. And I think the overlap exists because in many cases, folk are sitting kind of at the intersection, some of their roles and responsibilities. And so we certainly have identified that. We're trying to think about how to best leverage people's efforts. I'll just note quickly, one of the challenges we've discovered is that often the people that find themselves on the RE committees, and right, and they're sometimes on two different committees, they're getting exhausted. Because you know, the folk that are sometimes doing the diversity inclusion work, it's work that's for a long haul. And it is a lot of pouring your soul out because the work matters to you. But we are also very mindful of respecting people and their humanity and trying not to place them in a situation where they're just beyond capacity. And so that is the kind of a constant ongoing dance, I think, that we have to do, making sure people aren't on too many committees or they are not stretched beyond capacity. Oh, Grace, did the complicating receive any pushback? Actually, and surprisingly, not very much. Most individuals had questions about sometimes keeping the statue, but once we began to explain it and they've seen the renderings of the statue, they have been blown away, right? On either side of the idea of complicating, right? The history, they've been blown away, and in many, if not most cases, actually compelled and drawn into it because of the way we've I think engaged this effort and the level of I think investment of many different folk from across campus and doing the work at the same time. Thank you. If you're interested, you can go to YouTube and you put in Enslaved Children of George Mason, which was the summer project, and then Enslaved People of George Mason Memorial. There are a couple of more professionally made videos by the GMU TV. So that if that's of interest, that's available and easily accessible.
I do have one more question from Mike. Do you have instances by survey or otherwise? The perception of Mason students and diversity and inclusivity?
Yes, we do. Short answer is, for some time, students have said, yes, we are this incredibly diverse institution in terms of our students. That is not represented in terms of faculty. And that is something that we, like many other institutions of higher ed, that we need to work on. So that's been a sticking point that we, again, back to the policies and procedures, part one, part two, students have said, yeah, we're really diverse, but we don't necessarily know how to make sure everybody feels included. and that's in their common spaces, and that's also in the classroom. And so that's another example, I think, of where listening to student really matters, and simply saying, okay, we're really diverse is not enough. We have to go beyond that to the inclusion piece. And students have been very vocal about that. All righty. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate y'all. And I'll have to sit with you, Carla, another time, but it's nice to see you. Thank I'm gonna go you. Hang and sit next to my mama right now.
Yeah, mamas are important. Thank you so much. And I know we'll be in touch as we go forward. Thank you, and enjoy your visit with your mom.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay, we ready for Carla?
My turn?
Yes, it's your turn. Hi, Carla.
Hello, how are you?
Susan again. Great to see you tonight.
Great to see you.
Thank you. Our second speaker tonight is Carla Bruce. She is the Chief Equity Officer for Fairfax County. And that is a first to have a chief equity officer for our neighboring county. And she was really the one with county government who championed what is now known as One Fairfax, looking at racial and social equity. She championed that resolution and policy, and now she oversees the management and direction of One Fairfax. Carla has a wonderful background in local government with 20 years of experience. And when I read her biography, it says she's known as, quote, a driver of innovation in public service. And certainly, I think what you're doing now with One Fairfax is one of those innovations. And we certainly look forward to hearing about that tonight from you, Carla. But I have to admit, Carla and I started talking when we were preparing for tonight. We started talking about some connections that we have in Hardy County, West Virginia. And Carla, I am sorry, I forgot to ask you then about your background, your educational background. So before you start, if you'll just share that with us and then go ahead with your presentation on One Fairfax. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. We got so caught up in our ties. The conversation went in a completely different direction. But I have a bachelor's degree in exercise and sports science from Pennsylvania State University, but my master's degree in public administration is from George Mason. So I am a proud George Mason grad. Too bad that Dr. Manuel Scott is not here to hear that. I came to the county as was said 21, almost 22 years ago as a recreation therapist and have had different careers over this 22 years, primarily in the field of human services, but that's really sort of what led me down the path to better understanding the inequities that exist in Fairfax County. Like Susan said, championing this embrace of this idea of equity in what became our One Fairfax policy. So I do have a few slides to share. So let me figure out how to share my screen in 1 second. Okay, are you all able to see my screen?
Yes.
Very good. So, I've been introduced. I'm Carla Bruce. I'm the Chief Equity Officer for Fairfax County Government. And I will just mention that there are now several Chief Equity Officers in the Washington metropolitan region, but Fairfax County was the first to establish this position. There are now 8 or maybe even 9 chief equity officers in the jurisdictions that make up the Washington metropolitan area. So I'm very proud of the work that we're doing in Fairfax around one this idea of One Fairfax, and really am here tonight just to give you a bit of background sort of an insight into some of the concepts that support this idea, and hopefully make the link to history. But as Wendy said earlier, it's understanding our history so that we can really think about how our history impacts our current reality. So I will go through the slides and try to be mindful of time. I apologize if I rush, but am happy to talk more and really want to make sure we're leaving time for questions later. But let me begin first with this map of Fairfax County. It comes from a report called The Uneven Opportunity Landscape in Northern Virginia, which was developed by the Center for Society and Health at Virginia Commonwealth University with support from the Northern Virginia Health Foundation. The report looked at things like housing, employment, education, access to healthcare, and other things that we would all want in our community, and identified that there are areas in the county where opportunities exist and also where they are lacking. And so what we come to understand is that there are really interlocking systemic barriers to housing, health, employment, transportation that have blocked opportunity in some areas. And so you'll see these areas in yellow, and what the report calls these areas are islands of disadvantage. So this is not the only report that shows data like this. There have been reports from the Urban Institute and Policy Link that show variances in opportunity and vulnerability across Fairfax County, and really helps us understand that the rewards of our economic growth have really bypassed a significant number of county residents. So what it led us to believe, to understand as a county, and again, it's this report and many others, and really just looking at our own data, is that if we're really going to address these issues, we're going to need to be place-based and system-focused to address these issues at a spatial level, at a geographic level. And so we know that there are inequities, and that sort of, if you look at these areas that are in yellow, we also know that places are also tied with race, in that many people of color live in these so-called islands of disadvantage. So it's gonna require bold, collaborative, cross-sector work to reverse these trends and address what's really at the root cause of these deeply entrenched challenges. If we address these inequities and ensure equitable access for economic mobility, then in Fairfax County, everyone will be able to thrive. And that's really the basis of One Fairfax. So One Fairfax is a racial and social equity. First, it was a resolution passed in July 2016, and then a policy that was passed in November 2017 by the Board of Supervisors and the school board, committing the county and the schools to intentionally consider equity in making our policies and planning and when we deliver our programs and services. It covers the breadth and depth of what the counties and the schools do across 19 areas of focus. The policy is being operationalized in the county through community and stakeholder engagement, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later in the presentation, building up the organizational capacity of our organization to consider equity in our planning and policy through training and support, utilizing data better to understand where we are now and really to get a sense of our progress and how we're doing, and working together in a real shared accountability sort of way to achieve more equitable results. At its core, One Fairfax centers on two fundamental questions, and it's really about understanding who benefits and who is burdened by past and current actions, and how those burdens can be mitigated and benefits more broadly shared. It's a way to really think about and how we approach government. It's not a program in and of itself. It's not an initiative, which would suggest that there's sort of a beginning and an end. It really is a way to govern and manage. And so to do that, we have to acknowledge our history and realize how that history connects to our current reality. We have to think about sort of where we are now and where we want to be in the future, and then be prepared to set goals and make clear priorities and explicit choices, because, you know, we are not in a resource sort of unlimited environment. It is going to require us to make choices that would really focus on the things that will work to advance equity. It's also going to require us to do things differently and to be bold and innovative in our approaches. And like I said before, to do that with the voice of the community centered. Again, the policy focuses on the actions of government, but what we realize is that it's the voice of community that helps us to better understand how the doors of opportunity have been opened or closed to different populations. And so it's an important element of our commitment to One Fairfax. Fairfax County is also a member of the Government Alliance on Race and Equity, which is a national organization of jurisdictions who have made a commitment to better understand the inequities that exist in our communities and to commit to addressing them. And their framework for change, which we have adopted, is normalize, organize, and operationalize. And just quickly, what that means is that when we say normalizing, what that means is that we want to name that we're working on racial equity and be able to describe why racial equity is our focus, understanding the definitions of equity and inequity, and really making equity a priority. Organizing is about ensuring that we have the structure set up to support our equity work. So when I was hired or appointed to this role back in June of 2018, that was a commitment to begin building the infrastructure. And what I have been doing is supporting our county executive and our board of supervisors and the whole organization to build up our capacity to understand how inequity is present in our community, but also how to build up the information and the tools that will help us to address it through our policy and practice. Partnership with the community is a part of organizing. And so again, not just centering the voices of the community, but also being in partnership with the community. We recognize that while local government has a really important role to play, that local government can't sort of do everything. We have to work with other sectors, the business community, the private sector, philanthropy, the faith community, because they all have a role in advancing racial equity. And then operationalizing, it really refers to being data-driven and using racial equity tools. Data, both in numbers that show how we're doing, as well as the voice of community, more qualitative sources of data, are really important to helping us measure our success. It's taking place at two levels. That measurement is to measure the success of specific actions that were taken, programmatic action, policy changes. And then it's also very important around establishing baselines and setting goals and measuring progress toward achieving those goals. Operationalizing also means that the racial equity tools that we're using are being actively used in our decision-making. Sometimes you'll hear people refer to equity tools as applying an equity lens. And that's what we're talking about. We want equity to really inform how we understand situations and problems, and then how we go about devising solutions. And then finally, we have to have a vision. And that vision for us is becoming One Fairfax, a Fairfax County where everybody, regardless of their race or other social characteristics, will be able to thrive and live to their fullest potential. I also want to just, again, given sort of the work that you all are doing, you know, think about the idea of government and race, the history of government and race. So it's really in three phases. The first phase is that, you know, it just has to be an acknowledgement that there is a sort of inextricable link between the history of government and the concept of race. So in the first phase, you can sort of think about government as being explicit in their acts of racial oppression. So government at the federal level, at the state level, at the local level, would pass and enforce laws that could determine who could vote, who could be a citizen, who could own property, who was property, whose land was whose, where you could live, who you could marry, whose military service would be honored and whose would not. So many things that really define our access to opportunity are really functions that are controlled by government, and where there was a period of time when there were laws in place that limited people's access to opportunity. So we know that, you know, history tells us that we had the passage of the 13th, 14th, and 15th constitutional amendments, and that ended slavery, that provided equal protection under the law, and it allowed all Black men to vote. We also had the 19th Amendment, which allowed women to vote, and later had Brown versus the Board of Education and the Civil Rights Act and other acts around voting and fair housing. Now, we also know that these things can also change over time, but the idea is that at a certain point, government enacted laws that were intended to limit that oppression. But we know it didn't happen because government just all of a sudden one day decided that, okay, we're going to do this. It happened because people came together in mass protest and in tactical coalitions to change laws in our country. Now, what happened is that those actions then became not so much explicit, but more implicit. So discrimination became illegal, and we sort of moved to this era of race neutral policies and practices. But what happened is it still perpetuated inequity. So it is necessary to address and acknowledge that race is still a factor in creating inequity, even when the laws are so-called race neutral. And if we want to make progress, we're going to have to acknowledge that. So the era that we find ourselves in now is an era that we are, where people in government are acknowledging that, and we're making efforts to transform it from the inside by focusing on proactive policies and practices that advance racial equity. So the Government Alliance on Race and Equity was formed about, I think, 5 or 6 years ago. And at the time when we joined the organization at its beginning, we were one of, I think, 9 jurisdictions in the country. There are now 333 jurisdictions that make up the membership of GAIR. So what we know is that in the United States and in Fairfax County, race is a predictor of how well you'll do. And, you know, it exists across every single indicator for success, no matter where you are, where you live. There are other characteristics that people may have that deserve attention: age, sex, sexual orientation, gender identity, religion, national origin, et cetera. And we think those things are important too. So again, One Fairfax is a racial and social equity policy. But we center race because what we know is that even across those other so-called areas of marginalization, race continues to be a predictor of success. So as an example, for women who are sort of consistently underpaid for doing the same or similar work, even when their education and experience are on par with men, so we know that to be the case, but when we disaggregate pay data by race, we also see that Black women and Latina are also paid less than whites. So, right, it's not just the social category of being a woman, but you still fare worse if you are a woman of color. And so that's why we continue to center race, while we also acknowledge that there are other areas of marginalization that need to be considered. So with our focus on equity, what we're saying is that equity exists when you can no longer predict advantage or disadvantage by a person's group identity. and that we're focusing not just on equity, but specifically on racial inequity, which means we're focusing on closing gaps so that race is no longer a predictor of success, while also improving outcomes for all. I'm sure this, you probably have seen this graphic before. It's been circulated widely over the last couple of years. And I think it's a good example of the definite, when you talk about equity, understanding the language that we're using. So we like to think of equity as being about fairness and not sameness. So in this graphic, you see on the left, what would we could consider as the definition of equality, the sort of uniform distribution or one box for each person. Even though what we see is this distribution of boxes isn't helping the kids on the screen be able to reach the goal. The ultimate goal is to see the game. With an equal or uniform distribution of resources, you're still not providing them the opportunity to watch the game. The definition of equity, though, is reflected on the right, and that's about fairness, and it ensures that people get what they need where they are, in, you know, considering their circumstances, recognizing that socioeconomic status, ability, geography, access to resources are different for everyone. So our approach to advancing equity is not about taking, you know, sort of thinking about people from an equality perspective, but really thinking about what people need to achieve the goal. Now, the challenge with this slide is that I think what it does is it introduces a scarcity narrative, and it suggests that you have to take from one person to give it to another. So on the equality side, you'll notice that the kid in the yellow pants has a box. On the equity side, you'll see that he no longer has a box, but the kid on the right has a purple box. And it started to make people say, well, wait a minute, you had to take something away from that guy to give it to the guy on the right. And that's really not what we're doing. That's a scarcity narrative. That's not, it's about winners and losers. So what we're focusing on is this commitment to fairness, to promote fairness and justice in our formation of public policies, which gives everybody the opportunity to thrive. We think this is a better depiction of the concept of equality versus equity. It's similar to the one on the previous slide, but what you'll notice here is that all three people are about the same height. So in the previous slide, there was a tall guy, a medium-sized guy, and a small guy, which really suggested that there was some sort of deficiency or difference in the people that was really driving our decision-making. In reality, that's not what we're focusing on. It's not the people's lack that's preventing them from seeing the game. In reality, it's their conditions. It's the graded ground and the sloping fence that really are reflecting the systemic nature of racial injustice. So what our focus then needs to be is not on the people necessarily. Yes, we want better outcomes for the people, but what we're looking to change is the conditions in which they exist. So it's, again, it's not the people's lack preventing them from seeing the game, it's the unjust system and structure. And so equity takes into consideration historical injustices that have resulted in imbalances. We see it's different, the landscape where these folks are standing, the ground is uneven. So that's what we're focusing on, changing that landscape, thinking about that previous slide I showed with these, those yellow areas. There's something uneven in those areas that are contributing to the inequitable outcomes of the people. And we're also focusing on this idea of racism. And I think that, you know, again, the name racism, the term racism is one that I think is often misunderstood. And I think it's important to articulate how we're thinking about it. So of course, individual racism, the prejudgment, bias, discrimination of, you know, by an individual based on race or directed at another individual. is something that we do not support, that we really actively try and address within our institution and hope that it is a value in our community that is not supported. But that is not our focus, or our central focus, I will say, in One Fairfax. What we think of for One Fairfax more is about that presence of institutional racism. So institutional racism includes policies, practices, and procedures that work better for one group than they do another. So what we're talking about is policies, practices, and procedures that work better for white people than they do for people of color, often unintentionally, sometimes inadvertently, sometimes in very intentional ways. But institutional racism occurs within institutions and organizations such as schools and businesses and governments when we adopt and maintain policies that routinely produce inequitable outcomes for people of color. Now, when these institutions start to come together and form structures in the community, right? So if you can think about, how does our housing system intersect with our transportation system, intersect with our food system, that's when you begin to think of structural racism. So it's that historic and current reality of institutional racism across multiple institutions combining to create systems or environments that negatively create or impact communities of color. One Fairfax is a commitment countywide. So my role is embedded in the office of the county executive so that I can have a full county view of where inequity is, where it exists, and how we can work together across our departments to address it. So this slide shows the overall structure of One Fairfax. We start with collective leadership. That's this top row. That's my role, and it's the role of the county executive and the board of supervisors and our entire senior management team, where we come together to really support this view about wanting to become One Fairfax and being willing to make policy choices and programmatic choices that will support that vision. But we're also working at the departmental level, and how we're doing that is with equity leads and teams and ambassadors who represent all of the county agencies. This, of course, is not an extensive exhaustive list of agencies. There's over 40 county agencies, and each one of them have an equity lead and team and ambassadors who are looking at their respective business areas and how equity is a is an issue affecting their work, both internally to their organization, but most importantly, externally in terms of the outcomes they are producing in the community. What we're also doing, though, is looking at how we can strategically integrate policy and practice, because it's not just what the individual agencies are doing, it's also sort of what we're doing, what we are doing or what we can do when we work together. Because what we ultimately want to ensure is that every resident in Fairfax County has access to the amenities that we all want in our communities, that we are unlocking the potential of every resident in every area of the county. And as I mentioned, to do this, we have to center the voice of the community. And when I say communities, it's the residents, but it's also partners and other stakeholders. Like I said, this is, government can make a commitment to advancing equity, but we can't do it alone. We have to do it in relationship and partnership to understand how the doors of opportunity are opened and closed, to contribute to an this understanding of what's driving the inequity so that we're not just addressing the symptoms, we're really looking at our challenges at the root level. Also, it's important to work with the community because we have to adopt a set of values in narrative that support the importance of equity, recognizing that we want to you know, work with groups who are impacted by the inequity, but we also want to work with groups who, from their vantage point, see Fairfax as it is, a great place to live, learn, work, and play. That's absolutely right. It is. But we want to make sure that those opportunities are afforded to more people, are afforded to everybody. And so we also need to engage people who may not be experiencing inequity, but need to be able to support some of the policy changes and choices we need to make to ensure that opportunity is available for all. And it's about co-creating the solutions. Like I said, this is not about just what the government is doing. It's all about how we can work in partnership. And the vehicle that we're using for this partnership and prioritization is our countywide strategic plan, where we're really thinking about how we can turn those islands of disadvantage into communities of opportunity so that we can promote the success of all neighborhoods and all populations in the county. Quickly, I won't go into it, but the county did engage in a strategic planning process a couple of years ago. It ended up, maybe about a year and a half ago, just prior to COVID, we ended up sort of going on a bit of a hiatus because of COVID, but are now sort of picking that work back up. In the beginning, though, where we started is that we identified these 9 areas as our strategic plan priority areas. And so when we think about what does it mean to advance equity, what we really need to think about is how are people doing in relationship to these 9 areas? And where we see gaps, how can we close those gaps? So our equity goals are not sort of a separate set of goals. Our equity goals are really about ensuring how everyone in the county is able to sort of have success around these 9 areas. That principle sort of that we're utilizing is one that was coined by Professor John Powell. And I would encourage you to look into it, to that work, to just simplify it. What our focus is on is about adopting broad goals, like our countywide goals. Fairfax County is a great place to live, learn, work, and play, and we celebrate that. But we recognize that there are gaps in opportunity across the county, and it is strategically important that we seek to close those gaps to ensure that all people in the county have an opportunity to succeed and live to their fullest potential. And the way that we'll do it is to concentrate on building, you know, not structural inequity, but opportunity structures, acknowledging that structural inequity exists, but turning that around so that we understand it and let it inform our work so that what we ultimately end up building are opportunity structures. And those opportunities are really, again, the same opportunities that we all need to thrive, right? So education, employment, mobility, like I said, what we want for the success of Fairfax County, we want for all people. We just need to recognize where those gaps are. I won't go into this, but the theory around this is communities of opportunity. So understanding first where vulnerability and opportunity are in the county. Mapping is an important part of this to really understand and be able to target our efforts on the places and populations where the needs are. And then as we understand that vulnerability and opportunity, our strategies are centered around where opportunity doesn't exist, where we can look to build opportunity, but also where it does exist. And again, this is not to suggest that opportunity doesn't exist in Fairfax County, it absolutely does. But what we wanna do is realize that there are some barriers to that opportunity. And we want to also focus on connecting people to opportunity. And then we also sort of tie it all together and realize that, you know, opportunity is not just about, you know, opportunity for education or opportunity for transportation. All of those things fit together in sort of a puzzle. And that puzzle is really something that we think about that we call an inclusive economy or inclusive prosperity. And when we fit these opportunities together, we will create an inclusive economy and people will be able to participate in it. And that's really the goal of One Fairfax. So as I said, this is not about, you know, naming races and, you know, thinking about things at the individual level, but really seeking to understand what's causing racial inequity, understanding the actions that are causing it, but also understanding the impacts of the inequity. And as we understand that, we also need to think at an institutional and structural level, who is responsible? What institutions are responsible so that we can make change at an institutional level in a proactive way versus in a way that's focused on sort of fixing things that have already happened? We want to use that historical perspective to help us to be more proactive in our solutions. So again, it's about the policy, right? So we adopted a policy that commits us to consider equity. It's a way that we are, as I described, governing and managing Fairfax County around fairness and not sameness, but also putting race at the center, recognizing that that is the predictor across of life success, across all major indicators of life success. Our focus, while, you know, it's important to think about this at the individual level as a government, it's our responsibility to really think about our role as an institution and how our role as an institution is contributing to structures that are producing inequity, and inviting others to recognize their role and how they can support this vision, this goal of becoming One Fairfax. I can share this presentation if you're interested. It includes links to many of the slides or the reports and background information that I referenced in the presentation. But with that, I will stop sharing, if I can figure out how to stop sharing. And I can't figure out how to stop sharing. There, stop share.
Well, thank you, Carla. That was terrific. You said you would do an overview, but I think that was much more than an overview. And certainly here in your neighboring jurisdiction of Fairfax City, we have many of the same goals and examining many of the same issues. I particularly like that your phrase community or communities of opportunity. And I think that's something I'm going to steal away here from you, because as we move forward beyond recommendations for Confederate related symbols, and all of that, we're going to be examining, of course, a lot of the issues that you discussed today. And with that, I'd just like to thank you again. And I'll turn it over to Melanie and see if there are any questions from our audience. Melanie?
Thank you, Susan. Anybody have any questions? Please put them in the chat or raise your hand and we will get to you.
Melanie, I don't know how to do raise the hand, but I have a question.
Go right ahead, Nikki.
I was looking for it. Hi, Carla. It's good to see you. I had said something to Susan a while back when we started that racist classes that every employee had to take that I thought helped a lot, but I couldn't think of it. Do you know what I'm talking about? When every employee had to take the racist, because it kind of like brought.
So I didn't mention that our employees are going, we are making available training. And one of those trainings, there's two core trainings. One is watching a documentary called Race, the Power of an Illusion, that I think is a fabulous orientation to the concept of race and the history of race in our country. It was originally a PBS documentary, but is now available on Vimeo. I'll look and see if I can find the link, and I'll put it in the chat. But we've made that available to all county employees. And then we also are doing a training called The Role of Government, in advancing equity so that we can begin to appreciate our role as public servants and how we need to think about this as a part of how we do our work and how we understand how we're doing our work, like what's the product of our work, the outcomes of our work. So training is a huge part of it. Again, what I presented to you was sort of what our plan, you know, sort of what our theoretical framework is for it, but there's a lot of deep work happening within our organization. And part of it is starting with helping our staff to understand these concepts.
And that leads. I really enjoyed, and I thought that helped the county within itself of the different groups and different cultures coming together and bringing their healing together. I know it was Paul, but I couldn't think of the name. I know it's racist stuff, but thank you so much.
Hello, this leads to our next question. What have you found to be the greatest challenge for this initiative given the enormity of the county?
The enormity of the county. I think, you know, we had a choice at the beginning to start small, right? And I think we made the right choice to make this a whole county effort. You know, the energy behind this work really started in human services because of the sort of persistent inequities that we saw in the delivery of our services. Who were the populations that were always faring the worst? But it helped us when we started to make a shift to start to think again. If you think back to that slide about that showed the two examples of watching a game. When we start to think about, we're emphasizing the people. We're putting a lot of energy into things we can do to change the people. What if we think about changing the conditions in which they live? What about if we think about changing the environment? And so that's what sort of helped us to understand that this had to be a countywide focus. Now, countywide focus in terms of a large organization, you know, again, 45, I think, departments in trying to do this work in, who have varying levels of understanding of these concepts, but also in a county of 1.2 million people in 400 square miles, right? In distinct differences about sort of the situations and conditions in each part of the county. So that's a challenge, but I'm very proud of the work that we're doing because what I'm seeing in staff is, you know, the willingness and the, you know, really the eagerness to understand understand what this means, because it really is explaining some, you know, persistent challenges that people couldn't put their finger on. Why is this happening? I'm working really hard. Why are we still continuing to have these challenges? And so this is beginning to offer an explanation. Do we always know what to do? No, you know, so there is no sort of guidebook or, you know, textbook that tells you how to do these things. And that's a challenge as well. But I think there is a genuine commitment across the organization to acknowledge that these are challenges and that, you know, even if we are not successful, you know, immediately, that we are on this journey together.
Great. Can you share some examples of what One Fairfax looks like in practice?
Sure. So, you know, I think one of the biggest examples is we're in the midst of right now, and it's sort of how we're responding to the pandemics. And so, you know, equity has been a central focus of our COVID-19 response. So if you all think back, you know, a year and a half ago, when sort of COVID arrived, you know, we were thinking about, okay, this, everybody is at risk, right? So we need to make sure that everybody stays home and everybody, you know, is able to protect themselves from the disease. But what we found is that there are certain populations who were at greater exposure risk, right? And there were certain populations who had pre-existing conditions that made it more likely that even when exposed, they would have worse health outcomes. And when we looked at who that population was and why they were having the experiences they were happening, it got back to those same structural issues. It got back to jobs, what types of jobs that people have. You know, some people were able to very easily work from home. Other people had to go to work every day. Other people had to utilize public transportation. Again, all of these things put certain people at greater risk. And when you looked at who those people were, they tended to be lower income people and they tended to be people of color. And it just reinforced sort of what we had come to understand of the drivers of inequity. So we've used that to really tailor and target our approaches. At the beginning, when it was about testing, we really concentrated on offering testing to those populations. And now that the vaccine is available, we're really targeting and tailoring our approaches to make sure that those vulnerable populations have access to the vaccine. So that's just one, example that it's really reinforced, the importance of understanding issues from an equity perspective so that our solutions can be more informed and more targeted and effective when we apply them.
So we have two people asking sort of the same question, which you have kind of set up very nicely. How do you guys identify those populations, and what were the common denominators in the areas that were identified as the islands of disadvantage in Fairfax County?
Yeah, when I share the presentation with you, you can dig through the report where that phrase was coined. And I will say, I am not a big fan of the islands of disadvantage, that phrase, I know these areas, right? I know that in these areas, there are, there are very resilient people. There are people with, who are working hard, and to label these areas as disadvantaged is, doesn't sort of celebrate the resilience of and the strength of the people that make up these communities. But that, let me get off my soapbox on that. That was their phrase, and it's been helpful. It's been helpful data to use. But educational outcomes are pretty consistent. The types of housing that are available in those areas, those are the areas where you see higher concentrations of multifamily housing, so apartments versus single family homes. People who are lower income people of color. I mean, those are, the report has like 20 different indicators that that again are pretty consistent in terms of sort of the types of outcomes that that you see in those areas that show up in yellow. What I will say though is that, that's what we see in the data, but we have to realize that those things are not sort of just, the people, like people just happen to choose to live in these areas. That happened because of land use policy and sort of, where low-income housing is located in the county. It happened, and then the schools, those are also the areas of the county where the schools are lower performing. So all of these things, when I was talking about structural racism, these are the things that sort of fit together. So when you look at these sets of indicators, you can start to see sort of the systemic home associated with each of these indicators to get a better sense of the systems that are, like I said, sometimes, inadvertently really working together to produce these situations.
We have one more question. Recognizing that it doesn't fix the structural inequity on its own, but has been a topic of conversations in the city and the county, how do issues like streets, neighborhood names factor into the work of One Fairfax?
So I think, you know, so I'm actually involved with the county's effort around Confederate renaming. And I think it's important because I think it sends a message to the community about the values. And I said earlier on about how community voice is really important. And so, you know, nobody on, you know, in this meeting tonight, you know, none of us were involved in those, you know, the decisions and in the situations that happened, you know, centuries ago. But we see the product of it. And if we, you know, one of my favorite quotes is from Dr. Maya Angelou, and it is, I'll paraphrase, when you know better, you do better. And so when we see the outcomes of the sort of this, the historical trauma and harm and choose not to act, we see that, you know, we see that you know, these street names that are associated with the Confederacy, for some people continue to produce trauma and harm. So when we see that, and as a community choose not to act, what message do we send to the people about their value? And so, you know, I really appreciated how Wendy described how, George Mason is handling it by retaining the statue, but offering some context around that statue. So I'm not here to, you know, to weigh in on one side or the other about what to do in the renaming, you know, around the renaming policy. But what it does do, the act of doing it and engaging in the process, is a recognition that you're hearing the voices of the community that would suggest that, that are saying that the mere presence of, you know, of that history is producing harm and trauma, and it is in addressing that is important to, you know, to the leaders in where, you know, where I live. So, you know, hopefully that answers the question.
I think our stakeholder group is finding out the same sort of situation where it's better to possibly provide full information as opposed to taking everything away. Mm-hmm. You know, let's put it in real context.
Yeah.
I don't have any other questions. I will pass it over to Susan and say thank you so much. And I look forward to working with you. People don't necessarily know Carla is also the chair of the Council of Governments Chief Equity Officer group. So she is incredibly busy and a great resource. Thank you.
So I'm happy. I would just also say, just really happy to know that our Fairfax City neighbors are on this journey too. And that wherever we can be helpful, please feel free to reach out.
We definitely will.
Well, thank you, Carla, again, for all that information and your insight. I know that we will be calling on you as well as Wendy when we move forward. And I just appreciate your time today and your willingness to share your expertise and the county initiative of One Fairfax with our city community. So thank you. And I know you've probably had a long, long, busy day. So we'll certainly understand if you want to bow out at this moment, but certainly invite you, and you're welcome to continue for the third speaker, Gretchen Bulova from the city of Alexandria. And so I'd like to go ahead and introduce Gretchen, if she's ready. She is. And Gretchen is the director of Historic Alexandria, the Office of Historic Alexandria. She is a recognized national expert on Alexandria's history, And I consider certainly Gretchen a friend. We work together on several projects, and I appreciate your time, Gretchen, on this. Gretchen became the director of the Office of Historic Alexandria in January of 2019. And she started with the City of Alexandria in 1991 as a part-time collections manager at Gatsby's Tavern. She left Alexandria for a brief period and served as curator of ceramics and glass at the Daughters of American Revolution Museum. That's the DAR Museum in Washington, D.C. And then she returned to Alexandria then and later served as director for Gatsby's Tavern, and also then moving up and advancing to being director of the Office of Historic Alexandria. And like historic resources here in the city, we manage three sites, but I think Gretchen, you manage seven over there, and plus now a new one, which is called the Freedom House, which is the former slave trading location in antebellum Alexandria. And it's just going to, I think, be an absolutely tremendous asset to telling not only Alexandria's history, but our nation's history with that new site. And Gretchen has a bachelor's degree from William and Mary and a master's degree in museum studies from George Washington University. She served in many, many roles as part of her profession. She has been president of the Historic House Museum Consortium, of which our city's house museums are members of that organization. And she's also a past president of the Virginia Association for Museum, our museum organization for the Commonwealth of Virginia. So she has a wonderful background in all areas of museum management, museum collection, and also the broader history. And that's a little bit what she's going to talk to us about today, is what's called Alexandria's Remembrance Project. But she's also going to bring in some background on Alexandria changing street names. And when Gretchen and I talk, there are now other street names that are under review by the Office of Historic Alexandria. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Gretchen Bulova as our third speaker tonight. Gretchen?
Well, thank you, Susan. Thank you so much for inviting me to participate in this month's Connecting Fairfax City for All series. I really applaud and admire the foundational work that you are undertaking as a community. And it's really great to see so many familiar names, I won't say faces because I could see names on tonight's program, and it has been excellent so far. So I'm quite honored to be asked to be a part of this series. Again, my name is Gretchen Bulova. I'm the director of the Office of Historic Alexandria. We are a department of the City of Alexandria government. And we currently oversee, as Susan said, we oversee eight museums now. They're all public buildings ranging from a tavern to a firehouse to the segregated library. Along with these museums, we also oversee five additional historic sites, including the Contraband and Freedmen Cemetery, which has really become a gathering place for social justice and Black Lives Matter vigils and assemblies in the past year. We also manage the city's Alexandria Archaeology and the Archives and Records Management Program. Our department is currently coordinating the Alexandria Community Remembrance Project. This is our Equal Justice Initiative. And I co-chair this along with Audrey Davis, director of our Alexandria Black History Museum. And I'd like to share our work with you today, just kind of a brief overview of that program, because I really do think it has some good information for you as a community as well. So when you think of Alexandria, these images probably come to mind, right? We associate especially Old Town Alexandria with colonial history, the waterfront, and lots of brick. But today, this is a quiet street, just a block from City Hall, just a block from the bustling waterfront near the torpedo factory that warrants a deeper dive. On April 22, 1897, Richard Lacey accused Joseph McCoy, an 18-year-old African-American teenager who had worked for Lacey for years. Lacey accused him of sexually assaulting his daughter. McCoy was arrested without a warrant and locked in a cell at the Alexandria Police Station House, which is today's City Hall. On the evening of April 22nd, a mob of more than 100 people attempted to break down the door of the police station, but they were repulsed by the officers on duty. The mayor of Alexandria never took action after being informed of this first attack. And at 1 a.m. on April 23rd, a second and even larger mob attack overwhelmed the officers. Joseph McCoy was kidnapped from his cell and dragged to the southeast corner of Cameron and Lee Streets, where he was hanged. Joseph McCoy was lynched on April 23rd, 1897, at this location. Next to our Apothecary Museum, across from City Hall, at one of the busiest corners in Old Town, the corner of King and South Fairfax Streets, Benjamin Thomas was lynched on August 8, 1899. On Monday, August 7, 1899, police arrested 16-year-old African-American Benjamin Thomas, charging him with the attempted criminal assault of an 8-year-old white girl. He protested and proclaimed his innocence. It was her word against his. White rioters attacked the city jail on North St. Asaph Street, captured and dragged Thomas half a mile, all the way, hitting him with stones, bricks, and pieces of iron. He cried out for his mother. Under the shadow of City Hall and the police station, the youth was stabbed, kicked, shot, and hung from a lamppost. His mother, Elizabeth Thomas, said she could not bear to look at her boy. And Reverend Waring of Shiloh Baptist Church said Thomas was an honest boy and innocent of the crime that led to his lynching. Both men were buried in the Penny Hill Cemetery on the outskirts of Alexandria in a pauper's grave. No members of the mob were ever held accountable. The remnant of the original lamppost is visible in this old photo of Leadbeater's Corner. The post continued to be used as a mailbox. The history of Alexandria's racial terror lynching had all been forgotten through the work of systemic racism. Of the 4,743 documented lynchings in Virginia between 1882 and 84 occurred in Virginia, 11 occurred in Northern Virginia, and 2 occurred in Alexandria. Bringing this issue to light, as well as the need to end mass incarceration, excessive punishment, and racial inequality, is attorney, author, and founder of the Equal Justice Initiative, Brian Stevenson. If you have the opportunity to read his book, Just Mercy, or see the movie that was released in 2019, I highly recommend it. After years of research and social justice work, he opened the Legacy Museum and the National Memorial for Peace and Justice. This opened with a lot of fanfare on April 26, 2018. The museum's mission is the post-slavery treatment of African-Americans by whites And he has challenged the community, all communities, to own their difficult history and work to claim their lynching pillars. The Legacy Museum, From Enslavement to Mass Incarceration, is situated on a site in Montgomery, Alabama, where enslaved men, women, and children were once warehoused. A block from one of the most prominent slave auction spaces in America, the Legacy Museum is steps away from an Alabama dock and rail station where tens of thousands of enslaved Africans and African Americans were trafficked during the 19th century. On a site overlooking Montgomery, the National Lynching Memorial is a sacred space for truth-telling and reflection about racial terror in America and its legacy. More than 4,700 African-American men, women, and children were hanged, burned alive, shot, drowned, and beaten to death by white mobs between 1882 and 1968. Millions more fled the South as refugees from racial terror, profoundly impacting the entire nation. Until now, there hasn't been a national memorial acknowledging the victims of racial terror lynchings. The memorial contains a pillar for each community with a known lynching, a pillar that's part of the memorial, and a pillar that is for the community. EJI has created the Community Remembrance Project to partner with communities like Alexandria to document and memorialize victims of racial violence. They spent more than 10 years researching lynching victims throughout the nation and now serve as a resource and guiding force to foster meaningful dialogue about race and justice today. The ultimate goal of EJI's Community Remembrance Project is for communities to claim their lynching pillars. In these photos, you can see the hanging pillars that are part of the permanent memorial. And then there's a detail here of the Alexandria pillar that is to be claimed by our community. They also have a program to deliver soil collected from lynching locations, as well as a marker program to honor victims of racial terror. It's really up to every community to determine how they want to acknowledge, remember, memorialize, and heal. The Alexandria Community Remembrance Project was formally established by the Alexandria City Council in February of 2019. As a city government, we committed to a social justice journey. The structure for the ACRP emphasizes a partnership between the city, the faith community, and civic organizations. We have a steering committee that consists of 15 individuals who facilitate the work of the different committees. We have more than 200 members of the community working on these committees. Right now, of course, we're working via Zoom. With any organization, it is so important to have a clear mission and plan of action. And we initially outlined our plan of action as we wanted to establish committees, have an initial public meeting, conduct research on our two known lynching victims, develop educational programming, hold remembrance ceremonies for each of the individuals on the days that they were lynched, do descendant outreach, write and install markers, collect soil from the lynching locations, and do a public pilgrimage to EJI with our soil collections. Ultimately, all of this would culminate in claiming our lynching pillar. And it's important to note that we can't just simply go down to Montgomery, Alabama and pick up our pillar. We need to put in the time, do the social justice work, and claim this as a community. when the pandemic hit, we, like everyone else, pivoted slowly to the virtual platforms. A few of our committees continued to meet virtually, while some simply chose to wait until in-person meetings resume. But we began to offer online programs and opportunities for our committee members, and this also expanded the reach of our remembrance project. Our first remembrance was completely online, and we focused our efforts on creating a virtual in memoriam page. It included a city proclamation, a special poem by Kanicki Jakarta, our poet laureate, letters from elected officials, a eulogy from the current pastor of Roberts Memorial Church, where McCoy had worshiped, reading lists, and also, which I think is very important, we included a mental health note. For the August 8th, 2020 Benjamin Thomas remembrance, a small group of committee members, along with the mayor of Alexandria, Justin Wilson, and Sheriff Dana Lawhorn, laid a wreath at the lynching site. We also created a virtual in memoriam page for Benjamin Thomas. Just a few weeks ago, this past April 23rd, we did hold a small in-person ceremony to honor the life of Joseph McCoy and install a marker. We had 87 members of the community, along with elected officials and community leaders, come together really to tell a more honest story about Alexandria's past. And one of the most impactful statements to me was made by our police chief, Michael Brown, who said that the city government was simply not there to support all members of the community, just the white members. The Alexandria Community Remembrance Project is about recognizing these failures in our past to honor those individuals who were wronged by these acts of racial terror, and to use this information to correct injustices and inequities today. Last summer, we launched a 30-day social justice challenge throughout Alexandria that included readings, visits to historic sites, videos, and a lot of other opportunities to learn. And we definitely plan to do this again. We got tremendous feedback. In fact, we were so pleased that our program was recognized by EJI itself in their annual report. And that's the picture that you're seeing here. That was a nice surprise to open in the mail. This is a list of some of our past events, just to give you an idea of the range of programs that we offered. And I just wanted to go through quickly our next 3-year plan, just kind of like the broader view. So in 2021, we dedicated a marker to Joseph McCoy on April 23rd, and that marker and the installation dedication, you can see those photos here. And we plan to do the same for Benjamin Thomas on August 8th. We're in the process of doing descendant research, but the shutdown of libraries and other vital records facilities has really slowed down our efforts. And that hopefully as things start to reopen, we'll be able to work on our genealogy and try to reach out to descendants. For 22, our priority is to collect soil from the lynching locations and other African-American sites. And then in 23, take that soil as a community and pilgrimage to EJI as a community. And we also hope to create a documentary about this project and the lynching victims, as well as a publication. I just wanna say, it's our goal to retrieve this pillar in 23, but it's not up to us really as a community. And it's important to note that EJI hasn't released a pillar to any community in the United States. So they're setting the bar high and wanting communities to do the hard work. Well, this has been a quick overview of our program. To learn more about our work, watch our progress, and even participate in our programs, everyone is welcome. You don't have to live within the boundaries of the city of Alexandria to participate in our programs. I encourage you to sign up for our monthly newsletter on our website. So the website is here. And then when you scroll down, this is the image that you'll see to click on to see our community remembrance page. We are but one cog in the wheel in our work in the city of Alexandria, the All Alexandria Initiative. There are city, faith-led, and nonprofits working on racial equity, including our new City of Alexandria Equity Office, Act for Alexandria, and others. We have a common goal to become a welcoming, equitable, and inclusive city. If I have just a few more moments, Susan, I was just gonna say a few words about a few other initiatives. Is that okay? I know
yes, that's Gretchen.
Okay, please I know go ahead. Okay. So there's a few other initiatives that are under our department that I thought might be of interest. So Susan mentioned that we recently purchased the Freedom House Museum. We purchased the site in March of 2020, just as our museum system in the world was shutting down. This site was ground zero for the domestic slave trade and the office of five successive slave traders, the most notorious being Franklin and Armfield. And most Alexandrians, most people in this area just have no idea that slaves were trafficked through the city of Alexandria. So this building is the last remaining structure of the Alexandria slave pen. It was a temporary holding area for thousands of men, women, and children who were purchased in DC and the Chesapeake region and sold in the New Orleans and Natchez for a high price. And they were transported via ship by three ships. And they also were walked overland to Natchez. Our plan is to restore the building, to tell the stories of the enslaved who passed through the site, the lasting effects of slavery and the domestic slave trade, and to confront the hard, honest truths about race, class, and equity in this country. We're in the process of finalizing the historic structures report and planning to reopen this fall with three floors of exhibits. We will close again once we are ready to undergo the full building restoration. And I look forward to welcoming each of you at the Freedom House Museum this fall. We will be launching on May 25th an online exhibit featuring the Black Lives Remembered collection. And this is to coincide with the anniversary of the death of George Floyd. The exhibit includes images, poems, artwork, and stories collected in the past year as part of the Black Lives Matter movement. And as an aside, we have been running a parallel collecting initiative documenting the pandemic. We are also working to remove legacy language from city markers, websites, brochures, and guidebooks, developing a language guide, and then reviewing text. This is a big project, as you can imagine. And as part of this, we are also taking a second look at the street names in Alexandria, reviewing for Confederate history. There was a task force in 2016 that made recommendations to city council to contextualize the Appomattox statue in the middle of Washington and Prince Streets, to rename Jefferson Davis Highway in the city of Alexandria, and that requests for street renaming should be considered by city council under the existing process. This task force received more than 150 online comments and heard more than 60 speakers at its five public meetings. The information from this entire process is online, and the website is there for you on the screen, alexandriava.gov/confederate. at this time, our department is looking at the master list of street names in Alexandria, reviewing for its Confederate, potential Confederate history, just taking a second look at all the names in Alexandria. The Appomattox statue was taken down by its owners, the United Daughters of the Confederacy, on June 2nd, 2020. The statue was removed first, and then the base was removed a few weeks later. The UDC voluntarily removed the statue at their own expense in advance of the July 1, 2020 law passed by the Virginia General Assembly, which gave localities the ability to remove Confederate monuments. As a department, the Office of Historic Alexandria, we are committed to preserving and interpreting Alexandria's historic properties, archaeological sites, cultural resources, artifact collections, objects, archives, records, and personal story, Alexandria's diverse history, heritage, and stories within the broader context of American history. Thank you so much for this opportunity to share briefly some of our initiatives in Alexandria with you today. Thank you.
Thank you, Gretchen. I know I asked a lot of Gretchen to cover many topics that were related to the Fairfax Connecting for All here, and you did a marvelous job of that. And I know you're very busy now with all these extra things, but as you and I talked, it's been exciting, it's been energizing, and all museums and historic sites are really in a period of rethinking what do we do next. And it's really exciting with some of the things that we've uncovered, or hey, this makes a good story. Why haven't we interpreted this earlier? So we all have a lot of work to do in the museum field. And Gretchen, I just thank you very much for sharing what you're doing over there in Alexandria. I think we always look to Alexandria as a lead in these projects, and you've certainly taken that on with all of your expertise and training. So thank you. And thank you for being a friend to us here in the city of Fairfax. And I will turn it over to Melanie, if you have time for a few questions, Gretchen.
Sure.
Thank you, Gretchen. Thank you, Susan. Does anybody have any questions for Gretchen about Alexandria? You are doing a ton of work. That is unbelievable. I'm overwhelmed.
I know the hour is growing late, so I, you know, don't feel like you have to push everybody on questions. But
and I forgot to mention that Gretchen also chairs her son's Boy Scout mulch drive too.
Oh my gosh!
Some of you are very good customers on this call, so thank you. Well, I think you all know how, most of you know how to contact me. I'm happy to be a resource, and I enjoy the programs that you all have been offering, and I have the utmost admiration for everything that you're doing in the city of Fairfax. And, you know, if there's anything I can do, I'm happy to assist.
Can I ask you one quick question? Oh, here's one from Mike. What were or are the guiding principles for your group? This is an amazing undertaking.
That is a great question, Mike. And I'm not sure that we have them like basically spelled out, but we have more of a desire to tell the full story, right, of Alexandria's history. And the fact that most people had no idea that there were lynchings in Alexandria, I think that's that's like new information for most people. And people want to do more. They want to help. They want to use this project as a way to create change in the community. People are, especially in the past year, people are fired up. They want to see change in this world. And this is a great project, and it helps people kind of understand the roots behind things. I mean, really looking at redlining and voting rights and how a lot of this, laws are still on the books. We've commissioned Dr. Kristen Moon, who's an Alexandria resident, who's at the University of Mary Washington, and she's doing primary research into segregation and laws in Alexandria and some of the communities. So this is really helping us create some foundational work for the city. So I don't think I have a list of guiding principles to share, but I think we need to create one. So thank you.
We have a council member asking a question. You mentioned that Alexandria is doing a second review of Confederate names. When was the first review completed, and what were the overall results?
Yeah, there's been, there was a look in 2015 at the list, and it was revised in 2016. And it's interesting that as you dive deeper into research, like why was that street named that? It wasn't necessarily named after a Confederate general. Like Braxton was actually, we figured out, named after a signer of the Declaration of Independence. So, there were mistakes made, and scholarship is always changing. And, it's a matter of going through the primary sources and figuring out, why things were named and when. And it's interesting that we don't know that information, right? That we don't know why these streets were named when these streets were only named like 40, 50 years ago. So we're doing that now. And actually, those lists of street names are on the website. So if you go into that, the city website /Confederate, you can go through and see the minutes of the meetings, and then you can see the lists of street names and all the reports as well. And I do encourage you to look at that, as you're starting to go through this process.
That's great. Any other last minute questions from anyone?
I know we as a family are hoping to go visit EJI this summer now that things are opening up a little bit to pilgrimage down there. So some of you have probably made that journey, and we hope to do that as a family as well. And I encourage everyone to think about doing that.
Have you guys talked to Charlottesville about their pilgrimage and their experience?
Yeah, they had an amazing experience. Yeah. And there's actually a lot of churches, a lot of synagogues just in the Fairfax area that have led trips down there. So it's amazing. Some of the people who came to the April 23rd remembrance ceremony had just been down to EJI, and they saw that we were doing this when we sent out the press release, and they were inspired to come and be part of our audience. It was, to me, that was so powerful. It's like, it's all happening. All the connections are coming together. It's very exciting.
Right. Well, thank you so much, Gretchen. You guys are doing some amazing work in Alexandria, and we really appreciate you sharing all of that with us. Susan, did you want to say anything before I close us out?
Thank you. I'd just like to thank Gretchen again, and certainly Carla, if she's still on with us.
Yes.
And then invite everyone to join us again at 7 p.m. Thursday, June the 3rd, for our community listening and learning session. And for that one, we're going to look at processes that other neighboring jurisdictions have taken in researching and then making decisions on changing Confederate symbols, names of streets and neighborhoods. And for that session, we'll be joined by Denise Dressel, the staff person with Fairfax County, who's led that effort, along with the great research done by Fairfax County History Commission members, of which Gretchen is a past president, as I recall, of the History Commission. And then also our neighbors over in Maryland, Montgomery County, we will have Rebecca Ballo, who's a historic preservationist, and Tanya's, I won't get her name correct, but Saye, who is in with their community development and planning department. And those are the two people who are leading the effort in Montgomery County. And so we will welcome them and invite Gretchen and Carla back and everyone else with us tonight for those presentations to learn, to listen, and to learn more from our community neighbors. So thanks, everyone. And we'll hope to see you again soon virtually, and hopefully one day in person also.